This audiobook is dedicated to all of my friends who helped me get to where I am today. You know who you are, and when I find you, I'm going to kill you.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Nothing Sacred by Lewis Black. Read by the author.
Introduction. Why I Hate Authority. What am I doing writing a book? I can't sit still for that long. For reasons that now escape me, I wanted to be a Foreign Service officer. Who knows? Maybe I thought it was glamorous, or maybe the idea of travel just appealed to me. I doubt I was really interested in shaping American foreign policy. That sounded too much like work. I soon discovered how many requirements there were to qualify for a job in foreign service, and that's when I decided that I wanted to be a writer, because there were no requirements. All you had to say was, "I am a writer," and you became one. You didn't even have to write anything. You could just sit in a coffee shop with a notebook and stare into space with a slightly bemused look on your face, judging the weight of the world with a jaundiced eye. As you can see, you can be completely full of shit and still be a writer. Okay, maybe that's the one requirement. I also thought it was going to be a great way to meet girls, but it wasn't. Probably because as I was staring into space, I no doubt looked mildly retarded. You see, I wanted to write plays, which in retrospect is a lot harder than learning Mandarin, I think. How I ended up in this delusional state shall be saved for another time. Eventually, I began to fill the pages in front of me with words. It was exciting. It was romantic. And yet, I felt like I was losing my mind, listening to voices in my head while trying to overcome years of lethargy by sitting and stewing in my own juices for hours. My brain was constantly humming with a little voice that would cry out, "Are you insane? Who would want to read this drivel of yours, let alone perform it? There are real jobs even you can do and contribute to society. You are insane, aren't you? You just want to end up in an asylum somewhere where they will take care of you." And in the 20 or so years that I wrote plays, I made less than I would have if I'd chosen to be a migrant worker. And so after years of playwriting, I became a successful comic. Go figure. So imagine my surprise when Steve, my agent, called and asked me if I wanted to write a book. Without hesitation, I said, "Of course I want to write a book." But my brain was shouting, "You're insane." Doesn't everyone feel they can write a book? Doesn't everyone feel that with just a few tens of thousands of well-chosen words, they could put the earth right back on to its proper axis? Maybe that's not the case nowadays. Maybe everyone just wants to be on a reality TV show and have people write about them. With so many more places to drink coffee nowadays, I leaped at the opportunity to share my insights with the world. Ask someone to write a book, and that person's ego knows no bounds. After years of working as a comic, I know how to talk funny. But can I write funny? So that the words leap off the page in such a way that the reader is filled with glee? You don't know till you try, and there are legions of critics ready to tell you that you aren't funny in the least. So what was I going to write about? Certainly not politics, as the shelves are filled with wonderfully funny works that have successfully covered that subject, by writers from Art Buchwald to P.J. O'Rourke to Michael Moore. I am no David Sedaris or Dave Barry or Mark Twain. Jesus, Mark Twain, not only was he funny, but he's dead, and he's still funny. I picked up a cup of coffee and stared off into space. It's not so romantic when you actually have to have thoughts and write them down, especially now that I apparently had a severe case of ADD. My head just couldn't wrap itself around a topic, because I got bored immediately with any topic that came to mind. In my desperation to come up with an appropriate subject, I even considered writing about interior decorating, which I know nothing about. Then one day, while sitting on a plane, headed to God knows where, I had a revelation. I am constantly in the air sitting next to guys who are about my age, and they talk to me as if I am 20 years younger than they are. And they seem 20 years older than I am. They always seem to have sticks up their asses. Where was my stick, I wondered? Where did the stick come from? Was there something inherent in being an adult that I had missed? Why did so many of my generation seem to have gone on to become joyless and officious snots? How could Dick Cheney and George W. Bush be around my age, and yet it was as if we were living in parallel universes? Was there something wrong with me that when I heard the words, "get on board," I would rather drown? It's not a question of politics. It's deeper than that. It has to do with our points of view, the way we look at the world. Where did mine come from? That's what this book is about. Maybe I am emotionally stunted, but by the time I was in my early 20s, I had developed the way I look at life, and it hasn't changed much since then. This is the road I traveled, as I remember it, which may not always be accurate, since as I've gotten older, my memory has become a blender. And so we begin. Suburbia. Everybody knows this is nowhere. Neil Young. I was born in Washington, D.C. on August 30th, 1948. For those of you who believe in such things, my birth date makes me a Virgo, the sign of the anal retentive. The sign kind of sucks, really, and I don't know if it has helped or hindered me, but I am sure the stars do more than twinkle. I was raised in Silver Spring, Maryland. Of course, there is no spring there, and I can assure you no one was mining for silver. Its only claim to fame is that it is the largest unincorporated city in America. In other words, we were too lazy to govern ourselves. Our town motto was, "I'd like to vote, but I don't feel like driving." Silver Spring is a suburb of Washington, D.C., and all suburbs are identical. The houses may vary in size and design, but the game is the same. Everyone has the feeling that they are living in a special space, when in fact, there is nothing unique about it. Being brought up in suburbia is, therefore, like being born and raised nowhere. It is an oxygenated void. As a result, it prepares you for either depression or space travel. Have you ever heard of the great suburban writer? Well, I promise you never will. I can just imagine how chapter 3 would begin. So many leaves, so little time. I will buy a leaf blower. Growing up in suburbia, everyone was middle class. Everyone had a lawn and a car. Everyone was white, except for the maids who would arrive once a week to clean up after all of us. It's what I imagine South Africa was like during apartheid. There was a wide variety of white people, though. Italians, Irish, Poles, Russians, Jews, Catholics, WASPs. It may have been sterile, but we all seemed to get along. It was the 50s and America was booming. It was a time when Father actually knew best and there was a sitcom to prove it. Elvis Presley was changing the genetic structure of America's children. There were TV dinners, specially made, I guess, for watching TV. The USSR, however, presented a bit of a problem to the idyllic suburban American lifestyle. It was our sworn enemy, and it was going to bury us. They were evil, really evil, spectacularly evil. So evil, in fact, that if you had ever been a communist, you were tainted for life, or so said Senator Joe McCarthy. Communists apparently walked among us, like aliens, ready to convert us to their heathen ways at any opportunity. The commies were no better than child molesters. I didn't experience that level of paranoia again until I smoked pot. I never quite grasped this concept. My family came from Russia, and if they were any indication of the Soviet mentality, I didn't think we had much to worry about. My grandfather had come to the United States in 1916 and didn't realize he was here until 1967. Worst of all, the Soviets had the atomic bomb, and they were going to use it if they thought it was necessary. The good news was that we also had the A-bomb, and if the Ruskies got out of line, we would blow them all to kingdom come. At school, we kept getting mixed messages about the atom. It was used to create the weapon that blew the shit out of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But according to a Disney cartoon, Our Friend the atom was the best thing since sliced bread. It would, we were instructed, eventually answer any problem with which civilization...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.